So I want to talk about some of your own work outside of the movies, beginning with the tribute that you did, or your version of Batman, which is amazing.
Thank you.
So tell me what inspired that, and specifically the details that you put into that character.
Batman, my personal work is a thing where I've spent so much of my artistic life doing very specific concepts for people. So when I do my own personal work, when you're looking at it, some of it looks quite rough. There's no editing. I just go for it, and I do what pleases me in the moment. People ask me, do you know what it's going to look like when it's done? No. No idea. But I know I'm going to do Batman. I know that there's a Giger influence. I know that I would love, if I could cast Batman, it would be Clint Eastwood. Get off my lawn, you know, this kind of thing. And so I wanted an older Batman. I wanted somebody who had been through fights and who was bleeding, and I wanted a gore element. And so I just did the Batman that I always wanted. And I over-sculpted way too much biomechanical stuff, imagining that all of these compartments could flip open and deploy different elements or things that would assist him in crime fighting, or like more like a James Bond meets Batman scenario. But these works, I gotta tell you about this. Thank you for asking this question, I love this. I was in the shop system building my portfolio for many years, as many new people to effects will be doing. And as many people that have been established for a long time, we're still building our books, still building our resumes and our portfolios. But I had stopped doing my own personal work. The drive and the oomph from youth had settled a little bit because I was giving so much to my employers. So something very funny happened. I did a head called TikTok. But TikTok was, it occurred to me that there always should be a creature that is basically a haunted clock. And, you know, like a messed up clock, cuckoo clock. And so the reason why I bring this up is I sculpt this thing. It's got a nautical theme. I don't know why, but it works. And you've got this rotten clock that's kind of psychotic. And I went to copyright.org, if you don't mind me plugging them, in my area there. And I paid $35 and I got a copyright on the sculpture. I've never copywritten a sculpture in my life. Paramount owns it. 20th Century owns it. My bosses own it. You own it as a retail buy. But I don't own anything. I'm just a guy who's out there manifesting. And so to see a piece of paper, this is not an ego thing, but I was so happy because it changed my relationship with my own sculpture. Here's this head sitting there on the table. And I got a pedigree for it, right? Like the old Monster Makers pedigree from Aurora magazines. When we were little kids, we'd build a model kit, and you get something from Famous Monsters that said that you were a master model maker. And in adulthood, I go to copyright.gov, pay $35, and I put Don Lanning's Oz, or in this case, TikTok by Don Lanning, and they give me a certificate. We have so many artists out there in your readership that are doing amazing art. Copyright something. It's cheap, and you'll get it. Like the hairs on the back of your head will go, I own it. Here's my pedigree for it.
What inspired your Wizard of Oz series? Right. I particularly loved the flying monkey, right, which is ferocious.
We all own the Wizard of Oz. We've all been watching it forever. I have never read the books. I'm conscious of the flat art that goes with the books, but I, like many of you, I was raised on the 1939 movie, and I was watching the supplemental to it, as I will often do when I'm working in my shop, and there was Angela Lansbury on a 3-hour supplemental documentary on The Wizard of Oz. Somebody on the supplemental material was talking about how The Wizard of Oz had had different meaning for them throughout their life. As a child, they were bowled over by the witch and the action and the adventure of it. As an adult, they were impressed by the production design and the quality of the production. And then in later life, they were moved by the message and the fact that the metaphor of there's no place like home refers to the times of our youth or the people that we've lost, a place that you can't quite go back to. It was a movie about love. And it was also a movie about archetypes. So I'm sitting there working on Nip Tuck. I'm about to do a little bit on Star Trek, but I'm tired. I'm wildly fatigued from doing tiny cell structure, thousands of little pores and wounds and all this stuff. And so this is the time where I start doing my own work. I did TikTok, and I thought, gosh, wouldn't it be good for me if I were to take the archetypes of Oz and do the same thing I did with TikTok, which is just no editing, just go for it, just have fun. And in my case, I've only ever seen the 39 movie, and I identify it as one of the greatest years, if not the greatest year for movies. So I was like, oh yeah. And so once I started to walk around and think about that, oh, I'm gonna sculpt a Tin Man. Oh, well now he's, because I'm in contemporary culture, now he's steampunked out. He was tin, the face is still tin. This part of the neck is still there, but he's been retrofitted in some story that we're not aware of. But it's still Jack Haley. It's still the 1939 Tin Man, but also I'm referencing, same thing with Batman, Clint Eastwood. I'm using Clint Eastwood as a jump-off point because I want an intense but emotional face for the Tin Man. The Scarecrow that we'll show a picture to you is a kind of a sweet, stupid country boy. And he started as a metaphor, as a play on the word scarecrow. So the back of his head is this messed up crow, right? And I'm sculpting this evil crow, and I think this is too dirty. This is not in keeping with what I'm essaying here. So I turn it around and give it a sweet country boy face with a removable hat and straw that falls out of the hat. I copy wrote all these things like I told you about earlier, and that changes your feeling towards them. Not that you own them or that you're gonna sell them or that it's a marketing thing, but it's yours, and that's very rich. So to create the problem for myself of reimagining these archetypes, nobody needs to tell you who the Tin Man is. You know what that is. So hopefully you as the audience of it, you clear your mind, and you say, oh, that's the Tin Man. I've had people that may or may not love the pieces that I did, but they'll still come up and we'll talk at length about our love and our ownership of the Wizard of Oz. You own it. You own it. You own it. Everybody owns the Wizard of Oz. So I saw Todd McFarlane, McFarlane Toys, had done a version of the Wizard of Oz. The dolls, for me personally, were horrible. But the Cowardly Lion doll was amazing. You had Winky guard spikes going up through the body, and you had this wonderful, realistic lion screaming. Or yelling, roaring. And that's wonderful. So I thought to myself, well, Todd McFarlane did it. Why can't I do a Wizard of Oz? Now, the end of that, thank you for asking about that. It's a great pleasure for me. I do Monsterpalooza every year. It's the only trade show I do for myself. And I have tables coming up there, and I'm going to be introducing an evil tree guy. So I'm thinking about that. So now I'm walking around in my daily life, and I'm thinking about, you know, what does bark look like? You know, twisting trees, and what tool will do this effect? So it's very healthy for me to be expressing myself. And once again, to envision archetypes or reimagine an archetype is very healthy for you. You artists out there that are sculpting, as you are looking through and sifting through the internet or whatever your inspiration is, look at the Easter Bunny and say to yourself, if I were to retell the Easter Bunny, right? So, you know, what would I do? How would I make it different from anything that's been done before? And this is a wonderful exercise for us artists, for anybody, to kind of, what could I find that would make it interesting? And so that's really what the Oz stuff is about. I mentioned Monsterpalooza. I want everybody to come to Monsterpalooza. They put on a great show, and it's a true sense of family, and it's all the effects community, at least in Los Angeles. And we have a great show out there. If you're anywhere in the sound of my voice, please come visit us. We'd love to see you, and it's a real wonderful event.
So fairly recently, you started teaching.
I did, yeah.
What's that experience like, and do you find that it benefits your practice as a whole?
I told my dad, I said I was worried about teaching because I didn't want people to think I wasn't working anymore. And I was really a bonehead about this. I don't mind telling you this. Teachers are one of the greatest resources we have. The adventure that I'm currently having right now in my personal life as a teacher is as juicy, if not more juicy, than my first couple of days in the business or working at KMB. I'm having a really unexpected experience. I went to stand in for a buddy in a makeup school out in Los Angeles, and I had the most wonderful, beautiful young girl from Australia. And she said, I can't sculpt. She says, I don't like you. I don't like this place, and I hate clay, and I'm here for my parents, or I don't want this. And I said, okay, that's fine. And I showed her a few tricks. I showed her a few like really stupid things, like your relationship with the tool, how you're supposed to hold the tool, right? And I gave her some ideas, and she took some of the ideas, and she ended up, within 2 days, I had her brandishing this messed up head. And it was a head like this, with a worm traveling through it, and you could see the worm traveling under the skin. And then you could see the worm exit and come out, and there's this weird head. So there's this messed up sculpture. And this girl, this young girl like this, look at this, look at what I did. When that happens, you realize you touched somebody's life. I did a sculpture, somebody saw it, I started a new job that lasted 2 years. The course of my life was changed off one sculpture. If that child, if that person, if that student can take some of those lessons and hold on to it and use it, then you've actually helped somebody right there in the room with them. You've changed the complexion of their life and possibly given them something in the creative world to do. And we're not snobby in my world, but we recognize that a lot of people in the world are doing mundane jobs or repetition jobs or all variety of jobs where you make no money, lots of money, everything. But I think we have a great pride in being involved with the craft because we're selfish, because we love doing new things every day. We love being part of film and media because it's what reared us. It was our second set of parents. I was raised by my mother, my father, my social group, my buddies, our girlfriends, and movies. Right? I was a synthesis of Robert De Niro, the T-2000, and Dick Smith. And I would act like these people. I would posture myself, you know? I swear to God, I walked around like De Niro for years, you know, just scowling at people. What? Right?
So, not tanning your neck when you move your body.
Yeah, or just slow boiling people, just, you know, just what, you know, it's ridiculous. But I think that it's funny because worldwide, we all share this. This is a worldwide thing. Our lives are so colored by the movies that we watch and by these archetypes that we see. You know, Harrison Ford in Blade Runner is also in there. It becomes part of our mythology. And because we aren't deeply entrenched in a culture that's ritual-based or you have all this business going on, we're allowed in the world, in the modern world, to really pick and choose. And a lot of what is seen is our media and the reflection of the times that we come in and that we exist in. So I'm certainly a product. When you see this interview, this guy's a product of Lon Chaney Sr. This kid's sitting here, this guy's sitting here because of you know, these silent movies in the 20s. I actually believe that Lon Chaney could strike a pose that was so intense and do such an intense performance that that performance could not die. I believe this as a little kid. This moment of expression was so true that it would live on. Now, that's almost metaphysical, and I don't know that that necessarily can happen, but it lives on in film. So in a way, the child Don was right. And I love being part of it. To all of you out there listening to this interview, and I know Stuart will agree with me, if you feel the call to art, I don't care what it art is, get quiet. Most of our concerns are social and economic. Most of our lives are spent running around trying to pay the bills and keep our mates protected and safe. Take some time for yourself and get quiet. And get quiet. You don't have to meditate. You just have to put on some nice music that you love. And think about what you love. If it's art, if the answer comes up art, if it comes up media, your right to be in our business and our industry is just as strong as anybody else's. So come on. Get out here.
So where do you teach?
Now when I don't have a movie, what I do is, or my schedule opens up, what I do is I do my own personal classes for a company that I have called D3. And what this is it's 5 or 6 students. There are some venues where you can teach a large group of people, but I found that doing classes for people where I invite them to come in and either do a full-size maquette, which is one of the formats that I love, that I do professionally, or a quarter scale head like the one that I did for Star Trek, where you're able to dress it and put clothing on it. I do those classes in Los Angeles at the Kyoto Brothers. Those guys are the best guys in the world. They're famous for Killer Clowns from Outer Space, and they're my dear friends, and they give me a wonderful atmosphere for us to come and work in a shop. So while you're sitting there working with me on these sculptures, we look over and there's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle, but there's really work going on. As an educator, or as a new educator, I had a real problem with taking people into a rented room and talking about shops and this kind of thing, and we're in a rented room. There's nothing to look at. So I invite networking and people to go see the shop and branch out and get advice from the Kyoto Brothers or whatever shop that we're at. We've also done them at Creature Effects in Studio City. But these are very intense meditations that are a low price that you can handle. I got a little angry at some of the makeup schools. I love the makeup schools. I love what they do for us. But the prices can be very high, and it can exclude some of the people that love art and that need the education or need the overview. It's exclusionary, so those prices are very high. My price is great. You come out, you pay one price, you walk out Friday, and you got a big sculpture, and my fingerprint is not on it. I teach you and make you strong, and we block together. So I'm working on my sculpture, you stand next to me, and we go. And that's the only way that you can teach, and I'm very opinionated about this, because I don't think that people should screw with people's education. They should give them the real stuff. The Winston School has been an amazing thing for me because I met a partner, a fellow creator that agreed that we should give the student more than you can handle. It's a weird thing to say. I'm gonna show you techniques that you cannot do. And that's Matt Winston, the son of Stan Winston. And his father's gone now. And his father did wonderful things for our industry to turn it into a business and an industry. And in the wake of Stan passing away, his son Matt has done so well for us artists, giving us a venue and a school, a hub, if you will, for us to bring these techniques that we've worked so hard to get out of invention for the project that we're on, and give us a forum for us to share that with you and to share the craft. So I meet this guy and I say, I just bought a DVD over here from this company showing me ZBrush stuff, and I learned one thing for $60 on a DVD. And so I said, if we're going to do this, or if I'm going to be involved with it, we have to do the reanimator. What do they call that when you take the syringes? You do the overload. We have to overload the students with information. If you buy this DVD or this stream, you got to get something for it that you can take and put into your sculpture. Thank you for letting me talk about this. Once again, I have a great joy. I'm 48 now. Anybody who's 48 remembers when they were 18, it was yesterday. So life goes by so fast in a way, and it's a very romantic notion. I'm sure Jordu experiences this. I'm sure Casey Love experiences it, where you look over and you see some of your detail techniques in the voice of a new artist that's just coming up, that's in their 20s. It makes us not feel immortal, but it makes us feel great pride that our time in the chair had meaning and had some finesse, and that we gave you some of it, made you strong, and now it's your time. Very exciting, very exciting.
Finally, can you teach me very briefly how to do some bionic damage on my leg? Because I got to do that now.
That's so funny.
I'm so jealous you got to do
it's
that.
It's in the reveal. You have to, first of all, nobody's aware of it because it's not a problem. And it's just the presentation of it is you just have to lift your pant leg. Here, I'll do it up here so that you can see this. If the bionic damage is here, you have to have it prepared out. And so as soon as the clothing starts to move, da 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 da, and so you get you take a part of a radio, you get some Elmer's glue, in my case. You have to be 10 years old. You glue that onto your arm with Elmer's glue, then you take your mother's black eyebrow pencil and you go like this, outside of the wound. You cover it and go to your class. Da, 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 da. Go for a higher tenor. If you really want an intense react, da, 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 because that means Steve's and more. You people have no idea what I'm talking about. Lee Majors, and the $6 million man on ABC. Fantastic. I got to tell you about this really quick. We're little boys. And once again, the $6 million man was such a big deal because you have, if there was a weird sound effect, you could imagine yourself, you know, jumping 50 feet up here. And we just, what a wonderful thing. For a lot of kids, it was Cowboys and Indians. For our generation, it was. Anyways, you know what I'm talking about. Everybody else, go look at the video. DVD, excuse me.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stuart. I appreciate you. You're awesome, man. I appreciate such great questions. You guys have been very kind to me. I got to tell you about Rue Morgue. The magazines and the publications of our youth, they were able to give us information when we had none. It's different now. We got the internet, and it can't be overstated. I'm so glad that your organization and like organizations are still with us and still giving us information about the topics that we love. This is a resource for us to be able to come and read about the classic films and the new films. It gives me a place to come visit with you in a relaxed situation that's not where I'm sculpting or doing anything like that. And I just really appreciate it. I still do it in adult life. I still do it. I pore over these magazines, and sometimes I'm feeling nostalgia and remembering movies that I loved as a kid. And sometimes I'm reading about a movie that's coming out or an effect or something that I didn't even realize was coming. And I want to tell you something on this idea here. If you are an artist and if you are following in a life of art, buy yourself every magazine you can, every book that interests you, that has artistic inspiration, that has a bitchin' monster. Any toy that you like, any prop that you like, buy it. Dump it into your head. And when somebody says to you, can you sculpt a mummy? I got 10 mummies. Can you sculpt a werewolf? I got 10 werewolves. Why? Because you've indulged your brain in the media. As a child and as an adult, I haven't stopped yet. I'm still buying every magazine and every book and every toy that I can get a hold of if it sparks my interest. Many of the McFarlane dolls. I'm buying Hot Toys now, not to plug them, excuse me. But this is a company doing wonderful, realistic toys. And the heads are this big, and they're beautifully sculpted. They're sculpted like silicone heads. But anything that inspires you, and once again, Stuart, I want to thank you for being part of the last couple of decades of my life.